Okay, today we're going to cover material that you should know for lab one, which is about doing fluorescence, though at the ensemble level. We'll get to doing fluorescence at the single molecule level, which is sort of the latest and coolest stuff, later. So today's topic will be fluorescence. What is it? What is it good for? The basic setups. Also, you have to measure the lifetime of fluorophores, and we'll talk about what is the lifetime, and we'll talk about not one way of doing it, but actually two ways. And in your case, in particular, you will be called the frequency modulation or lifetime and phase modulation. It's the same thing. We'll also, if we get time, talk about 3D sectioning. That's a confocal microscopy. And if we have time, we'll even get to something that you won't do at all in your lab. It's called two-photon microscopy. Okay, and the reason to do fluorescence is because, you know, you get gorgeous images. Basically, that's the reason that I went into fluorescence. You know, how do you beat it? Now, of course, with the fluorescence, you need to add a fluorophore, that is, a molecule that will absorb light and then re-emit. And in fact, you can do that. Do yellow, red, blue, and there's a whole bunch of fluorophores out there. And in this case, this is 46 chromosomes or 23 pairs of chromosomes. This is from a person. And are they male or female? Male? How do you know? X and Y. Anything else? If two of each sound pretty good. Okay. So what is fluorescence? And that is, you take a molecule, you shine light at it of a particular color. Let's say it's blue. It absorbs some of that light, loses some of the energy, which we'll discuss in a second, and then emits the light back out. Because it's lost some of the energy, this is a redshift, or often called the Stokes shift. So if you have blue light, you get out some green light. If it's another fluorescent molecule that absorbs in the green, then you'll get out some orange light or some red light. The thing that you must realize is that not all molecules fluoresce. The prototypical fluorescent molecule is probably this one. It's called fluorescein. In fact, you're probably familiar with fluorescein. You know, when you're going and driving on the highway and you see some guys, you know, working away and they're wearing a jacket, yeah? And you see, like, it's like really yellow or orange, like hurts your eyes. That's because there's fluorescein in there. Fluorescein tends to emit in the yellowish kind of region. So why is it, in that case, so bright? It's like, is it a little light bulb in there? I mean, right? You look at it and it's like, whoa, back off. And then you go and hit the person. So In that particular case, why is it so bright? That's fine.
Just because it's absorbing light from the headlights and emitting.
Okay, well, usually, let's say, I think of it during the day.
Oh, okay.
So it's absorbing the sunlight. In fact, there's a wide range coming from the sun. UV all the way up that you don't actually see. The fluorescein takes it and then re-emits that light in a certain fairly narrow spectrum, yellow. And that's why you see that, wow, it's really bright. Okay, fluorescein is such a good fluorophore because it has a free electron. This is the image of fluorescein. An equivalent image is this. It's identical. So the electron is here or it's here. In fact, it's a resonance. In fact, the electron is basically free to move along this plane. So if it's free to move, what happens? You come in and you shine light, which is an electromagnetic wave. Let's say the wave is along this way. The electron will freely go back and forth. An electron is charged, right? Minus one. And it's going back and forth. So is the charge in a classical sense, is it accelerating? Going up and back and up and back. For sure it is. And what do you have with an accelerating charge? You get radiation. And so the electron, it initially is absorbing and going back and forth, but because it's going back and forth, it tends to re-radiate the light. And for, which we'll talk about next, the light that it actually radiates is a little bit lower energy. So, yes?
How is the electron able to move back and forth in the molecule? Is it through the concept of,
it's a resonance? Absolutely. This is a resonance. So, in fact, neither of these is so-called strictly true, in that the charge is not just here or not just here. In fact, it's a resonance. That's right. In fact, so if you shine light at it like this, the electron seems like it's relatively free to move. What if you shine light like this? Will the electron be free to move? Actually, in general, not. So in fact, the light is very much, the light that it absorbs is polarized light. And the emission that you get out, the electron is going up and back. Does that tend to be polarized? Yeah, exactly. Okay. So let's look now in detail about how this happens. What we have is we have a ground state. Mostly, they're down here. In fact, has some vibrational levels also, so it can populate a few of these, though not a lot. If you come in and you shine the light at a particular frequency, you'll drive the electron up via absorption, and you'll do this very quickly, on the order of a femtosecond. How long is a femtosecond? How many seconds is that? 10 to the minus 15 seconds. So it's really fast. And you'll drive it up to an excited level. You'll either go from here to here, or from here to here, or from here to here. What if you excite it, for example, with an energy which is from here to, for example, you know, up there? What happens? Nothing. Doesn't absorb. So there's a cutoff of where it absorbs. And in fact, I'll have you in a minute explain the absorption profile and then the emission profile. Okay, so in a femtosecond, you're up here. Then the electron, which has done the absorption, will relax. And it relaxes to this lowest excited state. Will be go about here. And the process of relaxation, which thermal relaxation, happens very fast, on the order of a picosecond. Then it goes here and it's happy. It's not that happy, because it will tend to radiate again from this. Even though there are no other photons around, just by itself, it'll be what's called spontaneous radiation. In fact, it was Albert Einstein who calculated how long this spontaneous radiation actually would occur. He also did things called stimulated emission from up here. And that, in fact, ultimately led to the laser. Okay, but you have it here, and it decides it's going to emit. And then what it emits, it goes from here back down to one of the ground states. It could be into these thermally excited manifolds over here, or it could be the ground state. That's it. The electron up there is then going to emit. That's fluorescence. However, it also cannot emit. It can go straight down to here or straight down to here and so forth, non-radiatively. What it does is it's hanging out there and it bumps into something else, or I don't know, just sort of gets tired and doesn't radiate. So how does it lose this energy? Thermal energy. What does thermal energy mean? Heat energy. What does heat mean? That's right. The molecule is there and it, you know, decides to twist a little or something like that. And that gives up its energy. Another way of putting it, in fact, for you, those of you who are involved in solid state, is it emits a series of phonons, which phonons are vibrations. And it emits a series of them and then goes down. And the fluorophores, the ones that fluoresce, tend to go down via radiation and tend not to go down via non-radiated. And then, so it comes down to one of these, and then here it will lose the energy to go back to the ground state or something very similar to that via thermal radiation, again, heat, and that process happens in a picosecond. Okay, so I want you to then to explain this. and that this should be nanometers, is the wavelength, and this is just the relative intensity. And then there is some excitation spectrum, and there's some emission spectrum. And notice something kind of interesting. See, here it tends to have a fairly sharp rise and a fairly sharp rise on the other one. And fairly long and fairly long. That is, they're basically mirror images. Why? Okay. Who knows? You've answered. Yeah. Okay, why don't you talk about it among yourselves and explain to me why this is the mirror image of that, approximately, and in this, from this kind of experiment. Good. Talk to your neighbor.
The absorption spectrum might be observed in like a shifted as you're going down. So that would be
I want you to, in particular, explain why there's this very sharp rise here, and there's a very sharp rise fall there.
Fantastic.
Okay. Do you have the answers for me? By the way, this is showing the excitation spectrum. Is that basically the same thing as the absorption spectrum? Yeah. Okay, so explain to me why you get all sorts of here absorbance over here, but then at some point comes off, shuts off.
There's a number of wavelengths you can absorb that not crossing that barrier to the excited state, but then once you get to that.
So where would that be on this picture?
The first.
Coming up. Woo!
Right. So we have many smaller amounts of energy that then once you get here, that would be the sort of cap.
Good.
This first one.
Okay, so does that mean it should be very on the short wavelength or the long wavelength? Mm-hmm. Why? Okay. Yeah, that's right. You have to remember this is energy, which is inversely related to the wavelength. Okay, so basically you go from here, you get nothing, whoo, and then all of a sudden you get something. And then, so then that is maximum. And then you can all absorb to, you know, to whatever. Okay. So that's on the excitation spectrum where you get a sharp fall off. What about on the emission spectrum? Why do you get a sharp fall off on the other end? Is it just speaking garbage, or? Yes.
So,
what's your name?
Jake.
So
when it gets absorbed and excited up to the beam,
yes, star, yeah.
Star, and through the thermal relaxation, eventually kind of falls down to the lowest one on the top.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I guess I'm not 100% sure this is it. The non-radiated thing, is that, so when it, does it still decay, it just doesn't fluoresce because it goes slower, or, I don't know, like, is it even a metaphoton when it's not, yeah, because it's non-radiated, it doesn't a metaphoton?
It, right, it or you could say it emits a bunch of phonons,
okay.
But a bunch of small energy packets, which will bring you back down, right?
Okay.
So in terms of emission, there isn't any.
Right. So then the bottom one to the top one on the bottom would...
From here to here.
Yes.
Huh?
That corresponds with one of the ends, so either the 600 or the 450 ends.
Okay, yeah. And with that, you're exactly correct. And which end is it? Is the...
I think it would be the 450 end, and that's why it's nothing spikes up. Whereas the other one has a more gradual, because it can go to each of the different ones.
Exactly. It can go here, it can go here, it can go here. Okay?
Whew. So what decides which of the intermediate lines
Well, it with absorption, it depends on what wavelength of light you're hitting it at, or what energy you're hitting it at. If you're hitting it way down here at, you know, 350 nanometers, goes here, and you know, if there's a state in an energy state that corresponds to the 350 nanometers, it goes there.
Does that mean that it could get, rather than an excitation spectra, a single excitation wavelength? It could always produce the same single emission wavelength?
Ah, there, it tends not to happen because you have a single excitation over here, but then you get some decay, which tends to be very rapid. And you tend to get decay back down to here. And then from here, you get excitation, emission. Okay? Yes?
So from the ground state of the star to the highest state of the, does that afford emission or fluorescence? Does that correspond to the color?
Okay, come up over here. I don't know which you're referring to. And I want you all to listen to this because you're going to answer her question, not me. Okay.
So my question is, I think Dick was saying that if you go from this level to that level, mm-hmm. you said it's perfect. I just wonder if it's perfect.
Is it?
The lower energy. So it would require less energy to go to here than to go. Or less energy would be emitted. Okay. So from here to here, it would be 450. And from here to here, it would be 100.
Okay. This is plotted versus energy. And this is plotted as a function of wavelength. And there are one over, that is, energy is equal to hc over lambda. Over. So you go to bigger lambda means smaller energy and vice versa. Yes?
Is thermal
Does the thermal relaxation from here down to here? Yes. Oh, always happens. Yeah. You mean what's Yeah, so if I understand correctly, the excitation spectrum, you do have a little bit out here, and let's say out to, let's say, 490. So in that, when you use 490 nanometers, that corresponds to, like, from here to here. What are you going to get at? Are you ever going to see, you know, emission down at below that, at 480 or 470? And the answer is basically no. You'll get emission beyond that. I'm not sure if you're always having relaxation, you're always having emission from there. So, yes, that you're always getting relaxation from there. So why don't I take this either during break or after class? Okay, and last thing about this, we wanted to know why was a mirror image of each other. And we had started to get it. And basically, what happens is there's certain sort of energy levels here, and the energy levels up here are exact, or not exactly, but pretty much spaced at the same amount. that it, the thermal relaxation of when it's in the ground state is the same as when it's in the excited state. And that, so that's what Monica was basically saying. Okay. That. And now, the other thing that happens is we talked about it gets absorbing in a femtosecond, relaxes here down to a picosecond. The fluorescence tends to be on the order of a nanosecond. And in fact, that's exactly what you see. That is, if you come in with a really sharp, fast pulse, and then you look at the fluorescence, you'll tend to see that it looks like that. The one thing that we have to do is we have to measure what this is. And you'll be spending a fair amount of time doing that. Let's look, though, for a second at what is this lifetime. If we say absorption is K up, and the rate at which it comes down is either K fluorescence plus some non-radiative. So in that case, the lifetime of this, when it's sitting up here and going to come down, is just 1 over the rate. Just 1 over this, which is 1 over KF plus K non-radiative. And there might be other processes involved here. And it turns out this is just a little introduction to the future. If you're familiar with FRET, which is Foster Resonance Energy Transfer, that can also affect these lifetimes. And we'll see about measuring this. Yes?
What do the K values represent just by themselves? Are they called anything? Do you have a name?
They're rate constants. And basically the time, so the time is in seconds or nanoseconds, and therefore the rate constant has units of inverse time. Okay? There is another important thing. Like all good things in life, it tends to end. That is, it tends to die. So, if you're exciting and exciting and exciting, at some point it undergoes some sort of chemical transformation and stops emitting. Typically, it emits something like 10 to the fifth or 10 to the 7th photons. That will actually be very important in terms of getting enough photons that you can see the thing. Okay, so this is an absorption graph. This is the absorbance, this is the emission. So where do you want to excite this? And where do you want to collect the fluorescence? Okay. You can do a maximum of both. Boy, they're pretty close then, right? Maximum, that difference is called the Stokes shift. Typically it's, 10 or 20 nanometers sort of thing. So you could do that, but it becomes kind of difficult if you excite at the maximum and then, try to look over here. So it typically you excite it, like over here, And then you put in a filter, so you get rid of the excitation light, and then you look over here. And you're going to have a series of dyes, and you have to pick the absorbance and emission spectra. Okay, I mentioned that not everything is fluorescent. In fact, even something like fluorescein can be fluorescent or cannot be. That is, here it's fluorescing, but if you protonate the oxygen, you're taking up and tying up that O minus such that it looks like here, also in fact, you're often protonizing this, then it's non-fluorescent. And in fact, this is at low pH, and the other one is at high pH. So this is really useful. How? Let's say you're in a cell, and you want to know what the pH is. You add a little bit of fluorescein, some parts really light up, and others don't. And in fact, that's because, for example, in what are called peroxisomes or lysosomes, something like that, it's known that it's very low pH, so it's deprotonated, so it emits like crazy. And others, which are, low pH tends not to emit, and then a high pH is other one, like pH 7, it tends to emit. Okay. Remember, last time I talked about why is fluorescence so good, is because in the absence of fluorophores, you see nothing. In the presence of fluorophore, you see a signal. That's a very good way of seeing it, because your signal to noise is really good. How does the signal relate to the number of photons it's putting out? Yes. Yeah, that's true. Now, I want to be a little bit more semi-quantitative. If you double the signal, you double the signal to noise. We talked about this last time. Gets multiplied by square root of 2. Where's square root of 2? No, it's not. You're getting there. Did you? Okay. What it is you have some intensity. That means a certain number of photons. Which is like N, which is the number of photons. There is always, always some noise in that. You think you're seeing 100 photons, but then you go and measure it again, Do you get in 100 photons? Do you get in 100 photons again? No, the answer is you don't. Maybe you get 102 photons. Maybe you get 104 photons. Maybe you get 97 photons. Maybe you get, 81 photons. There is inherent noise in a light-emitting object. This is n photons. And there's always plus or minus a little bit. This is 100. This is like 101. This is 99 and so forth. There is always noise. The noise approximately goes as the square root of the number of photons that you're seeing. Okay? That's true. Even if there's no other source of background besides the signal itself. Right? So the signal to noise, and the signal is going as n, and the noise, or this is n photons, is going as the square root of the number of photons. So the signal to noise is in fact going as the square root of the number of photons. That's true. Now, you might have some additional sources of noise. That is, there may be some background, which is, some background B photons. So your signal is S, your n photons. Your background is B. So the noise in that is equal to the background plus the number of photons, the square root of that. So the signal to noise is equal to the number of photons divided by the square root of B plus the number of photons. This concept is extremely important. I'm going to try to bang this into your head. So in this case, first case, what is B? What is the background? Zero. Even in that case, the best you get out is the signal to noise is the square root of the number of photons. Okay, now, in this case, with fluorescence, let's assume that there's no background. Just assume that. The signal to noise is going then as the square root of the number of photons. In general, if the signal to noise is greater than one or a couple, you can see it. So if, for example, then you get the number of photons is 100, the square root of that is 10, so you have a signal to noise of 10. So that says this one object is emitting of 100 photons. That's plenty for you to see, assuming that there's no background. Okay? However, with absorption, remember there we have a huge amount of background. We talked about this in the first class. Huge amount of background. And there's no way that you could see 100 photons because you're shining light in there and you're looking, you know, over here and you're looking for a tiny little signal on this. And by the way, if you were not here, I strongly recommend you looking at the video of it. Okay? So basically it's super sensitive, that is, it's a dark field technique. Ordinarily the background is zero, so the signal to noise is very good. So that's why we're interested in fluorescence. We're also interested in fluorescence because there's lots of different labels that you can do, from blue to green to red and so forth. So you can use it to label lots of different things. The problem with fluorescence is you have to introduce a fluorescent dye into your sample of interest. Sometimes that's easy. Sometimes it's a real pain in the butt, and you can't actually do the experiment. Okay? But this I actually covered last time, but we'll cover it very briefly here. In terms of the actual setup, you have a laser or an arc lamp. You basically put a colored filter in front of it, matching the absorbance of the thing that you want. You then steer that colored light, in this case the blue, through your objective and onto your sample. Most of it does not get absorbed, and so it doesn't matter. Just goes through. You never see that. A little bit of it gets absorbed and some of that fluoresces. It fluoresces green. This is collected by the same objective and then it goes and passes through another light, another filter, which is selective for that particular wavelength. What about this dichroic? Why is it called a dichroic? Two lenses? Two lights, yes? Okay, very good. That's what dichroic means. So what does dichroic really mean? So two lights, yes? What about it? Yes? Yeah, that's right. It reflects, in this case, fairly short wavelength, like blue, but it'll transmit longer wavelengths. That's right. And then you see it with either your eye, or nowadays there are very good electronic detectors. That we've gone over what the K radiative and K non-radiative, and the lifetime, which is just one over this. And by the way, the quantum yield, which is saying if you got in some photon into the fluorophore, what's the probability that it will give you a fluorescent photon out? That is simply equal to the radiative rate divided by the total rate. So if it's a really good fluorophore, its quantum yield is what? 0, 1, 10, 1. Because it's a very good fluorophore, therefore K non-radiative is 0. The quantum yield is 1. And if it's a really lousy fluorophore, as most things are, then K radiative is about 0, and the quantum yield is about 0. Let me just make one really brief comment. The fluorophores, I mentioned how they tend to die after a while. Well, in this case, fluorophores hate oxygen, because oxygen, molecular oxygen, is a triplet state, which will often take a fluorescent molecule and convert it into a triplet state, and then it becomes non-fluorescent. So if you can, you try to look at objects without oxygen. Okay, now comes the part of measuring the lifetime, and you will do this. And there's two ways of measuring the lifetime. The simplest way is you use a pulsed excitation. That is, you have your fluorophore there, and you come in with a very short pulse of light at the wavelength where the fluorophore absorbs. And then what happens is, you know, you get, for this an ensemble measurement, you get a whole bunch of them in the excited state. Some emit, you know, very fast, some a little bit more slowly, but on average, you get a range. And usually, that range is, it's basically a single exponential. And that's all there is to it. Though, in fact, you will find sometimes you get bi-exponential. You'll actually go and see that. And then what you're going to do is a more difficult experiment. And there you're going to measure in the frequency domain. And what you're going to do is you're not going to come in with a really short burst and then measure the decay. You're going to drive it at a particular frequency. And you're going to see the response of that frequency. So, for example, you have an excitation wavelength, which is going to be varying in time. It's still always around, let's say, 500 nanometers. But you're going to vary the intensity of that. It doesn't affect the life, the 500 nanometers, but you put in a big and then a slow. I mean, a big and then a small, and then a big and then a small. And you essentially get what is like a resonance effect. Can somebody tell me make an analogy between like either an RLC circuit or just a kid on a swing, you know, and you want to push the guy or the girl, and what you're doing is you're looking at the amplitude as a function of frequency. That's your input, and your output is how much the kid is actually swinging. This is sort of an analogy to what you're actually doing here. Let's pretend I'm a kid. I think I only heard one snicker, so that's good. Okay, so, okay, so I'm here, I'm my swing, and I want to go. How does that happen? I'm going to have someone push me. Okay? And let's say, but that person is just going to be there and going to push. And then at some frequency. So it could go like that or could, you know, go like that. There'll be some frequency where you'll really get going, even for relatively, you know, small input, right? And so we're going to do something like that with the fluorophores. We're still want a frequency, 500 nanometers or so, that it will know that it's there, but we're gonna push it and push it and push it, and we're going to vary the frequency. And what my resonant frequency is going to be a function of how tall the pendulum is, how much I'm weighing. If I eat a couple of bananas or something that day, I'll be heavier and it'll. So what you'll do is you'll take your excitation intensity, it'll have a certain AC component and also actually a certain DC component. And from there, I'll also then look at the emission side and I'll get some fluctuations on that. Not only will I get some fluctuations on that, but also there'll be a phase shift with regard to my input. So what you actually do is you look at the AC over DC amount for the emission, and you look at the AC over DC part for the excitation, and you take this ratio. And it turns out that that's equal to 1 plus omega, that's, you know, the equivalent to the 500 megahertz, times tau, which is your lifetime. Yes? It's the frequency of the driving force. Very, very good. Thank you. Omega is the frequency of the driving force. Okay? And also, so this is the modulation, or I don't know what they call it, the demodulation. Also, there'll tend to be a phase shift. and that's over there. And then what you do is you measure it at several different frequencies. In fact, typically you 15 or 20 frequencies. And then at that, so here's modulation ratio, and you get the demodulation frequency and the phase delay as a function of the frequency. Frequency in this case goes from like 10 megahertz to 100 megahertz. And you will actually do this and be able to measure your fluorescent lifetimes. You often get out not just one lifetime, but actually a range of lifetimes. Because there could be one lifetime, but you may get out of range because it's heterogeneous. If you're, for example, looking at a cell labeled with some fluorescence on one part of the cell versus another part of the cell, they might have very different lifetimes. Okay. Well, yeah.
I don't know how to word this question nicely, but what was the use of the frequency domains? Like, why does that help us see something? Like, what is the result in an experiment?
The question is, what, or maybe this is either your question or it's a different question. Why do you use frequency domain versus time domain?
I'm not sure what the end result of either of those are.
Okay. The end result is you get the fluorescent lifetime of the fluorophore that you're looking at. And it turns out which you do is really a matter of convenience, is the truth. Why do we care about the lifetime? And that's because let's imagine you're looking at a cell, a nucleus, and what's called the cytoplasm, and you know, there's all sorts of stuff going on here. And you've managed to label sort of this stuff over here with a particular fluorophore. You want to see now, is the environment that this guy is in is the same as this guy? You can do two things. One is you can look at the intensity. How bright is it here and how bright is this here? There's a problem with that. What's the problem by comparing the intensities? Does it indicate that if this one is brighter than this, that, for example, you know, this is a different pH around it than this one? Or, I don't know.
Non-uniform lighting.
Okay, let's say you have perfectly uniform light. Although you make a good point. That's true. You might have non-uniform lighting. But let's say you have no idea whether this part has, for some reason, gotten more fluorophores than this part over here. So if this is 10% or twice as bright as this, you don't know because the fluorophore, when you added it, it's a lot easier to go in here than to go in there. Or maybe, you know, you have twice the amount of material in over here versus over here. Now, let's say you can measure the lifetime of the thing. And let's say the lifetime is a function of pH. And in this one, you find that it measures the lifetime, either with the lifetime measurement or the frequency domain measurement. And this one, you know, you get a tau of 1 second. And this one, you know, you get a tau of two seconds. Then here, there's clearly a difference. And you can say, you know, that this one is right in the pH range where your fluorophore is likely to fluoresce. And in fact, you can, once you know that, then you can actually look at the total fluorescence also and say, okay, this is 2 nanoseconds. I would expect that to be brighter than the 1 nanosecond. Is it in fact the same or not? Okay, and so this frequency domain and to a certain extent the time domain really comes in when you're dealing with cells and you're dealing with heterogeneity. Okay. Why don't we give you a break till 2:15, and then maybe we'll continue again, or maybe I'll let you go. I'm not sure.
I have a hypothetical. Say you capture a fluorophore and you apply a magnetic or electric field. Would you broaden
when
the,
I came back, I do my
the emission or absorption spectrum?
Say it again.
Say you capture a single fluorophore.
Okay.
And you apply, I think it would probably be a magnetic field. Would you introduce more like the metastable state in my body?
You can.
Okay.
But it would in general have to be a pretty intense electric field or a magnetic field.
Right.
But theoretically, you can, like a Zeeman effect.
Exactly. I was wondering about that in the EFM or just like a trapping experiment.
That's right. That's exactly. But notice, in a trapping experiment, you generally have optical trapping. The electric field is, you know, enormous. And so you generally don't have to worry about that here. But yes, it could.
So there's no time wasted on the way out.
By the way, your questions were really good. Okay, let me give me a minute because I
so on this side, this is steeper because
of the so you rotated with the exponential direction. What do they do?
Jaya, do you think I should let them go, or I could talk about confocal microscopy?
I think the only thing is that, well, I guess Monday you can talk about that.
Yeah.
Right in the note. Okay.
So you still have Monday.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Because you just have how many cells?
Experimentally or?
Wow.
Is
there Fred in this? No. I could. I wasn't planning on introducing Fred, but. Can we, it wait about a half hour? Okay, thank you.
Are you? Yes. Whereas we have to work on the weekend, we can work on the weekend.
I think I will talk about Fred. Okay. Not surprisingly, I've decided to keep you. Though I was planning on going to 2:45 and I'll probably end more like in 15 minutes. Because I just want to introduce you to the idea of FRET, which stands for fluorescence, resonance energy transfer, or sometimes Foster resonance energy transfer. And we'll go into it more detail on Monday when we have time. But this is essentially the second half of lab number one, is to measure FRET. And the idea behind it is pretty simple. If you have two fluorophores, one which is red and one which is green, for example, green and red, if they're close together, and I'll define close together in a minute, then they will undergo FRET. And that is, the green, you go and excite it, and it gets excited. It turns out, if the red is close enough to it, it will go undergo what is called energy transfer and transfer that energy to the red. When it transfers that energy to the red, it comes down because they both can't be excited. The red starts emitting. So that's, imagine you have a scissor and you have a green and you have a red dye. The scissor is basically closed. The two dyes are close by. You go and excite the green dye, but in fact, what happens is you see red. In contrast, imagine that the scissor is open. You have the green dye and still have the red dye. And you come in and you excite the green dye. The green dye doesn't even know about the red dye. And so it just emits, just like we've seen, emits in the green. So if you can determine the amount of green dye and the amount of red dye, the emission, which is emitting more, you can get an idea of whether the scissor is closed or the scissor is open. Yes?
So it's not the green fluorescence is absorbed by the red.
It turns out that it is not the absorption of by the red dye on the green dye. So If you do a calculation, actually it's actually a very simple one, you look at it, the absorption of the red dye and see if it's enough by absorption just to absorb the green dye. And it turns out it isn't at all, not even close. Nevertheless, there's obviously an interaction between the green and the red dye that is not simply absorption and emission and then absorption. There is, it turns out, a dipole-dipole interaction, which it turns out goes as 1 over r to the sixth, where r is the distance between them. Because it's r to the sixth, where in general, if it was simply an emission corresponding to then a absorption, it would go as 1 over r or 1 over r squared. Yeah, I have to think about it. Okay? And the great thing about this is you can tell about whether the scissor is open or closed. And in particular, if you have, let's say, a piece of DNA or a piece of protein, that they will often, the protein, as part of its life cycle, will open or close depending on, you know, what it's doing. So you can actually monitor this protein open or closed. And it turns out that it's really useful in a range which tells you something about the protein or the DNA. It turns out that when the thing is about 20 angstroms or 2 nanometers, very small, then you get a lot of fret going on. When you're out to 80 angstroms or more, you get essentially no fret. So in general, the parameter to think about is on the order of 50 angstroms or 5 nanometers. So you can tell whether two parts of some protein are closer than that or farther apart than that. And that's really useful. Because often, for example, a protein, it will utilize ATP, adenosine triphosphate, which is the sort of universal gasoline of the cell. And the way it utilizes things is it binds and, you know, gets all snuggling and cozy with it. So you can see it actually binding. And this is more of why Fred is so useful, because it's useful in 2 scenarios. One is intramolecular. That is, you have a protein, and let's say you label it with a donor and an acceptor. And then you add some ligand to it. And the ligand causes a conformational change such that the donor and acceptor, that's what the 2 dyes are called, come very close to each other. You know, the scissor is the scissor closing. In which case, in this case, you get a lot of fret. In this case, you get little effect of fret. And that is incredibly useful. Why is it useful? Let me give you an example. Breast cancer is, you know, a huge problem. And there happens to be a receptor which binds a ligand called, the ligand is called EGF, epidermal growth factor. And in general, when you have breast cancer, the EGF receptor, that is EGFR receptor, tends to be really active. So in effect, it's sort of like this. So what you might want to do, in fact, this is in reality, is you want to come up with some external chemical, that is, a drug, which can compete with your normal EGF receptor, not receptor, normal EGF, and go in and prevent this binding and then closing. And in fact, so what you do is you go make and millions, literally millions of compounds and different ligands, and you test them with the EGFR that is involved in cancer. And you find out which ones will actually bind. And this is a very real example, in fact, that the drug companies do all the time. FRET is extremely useful for this. Okay, so that's on the intramolecular side. There's also the intermolecular, namely, you have two of these guys, and when they come together, you get a lot of FRET and a lot of FRET over here. So you can see also whether the dimerization or trimerization of something is happening. Okay. By the way, we talked about this is basically good for about 5 nanometers. You know, below that, you get a lot of FRET. Above that, you get very little FRET. In terms of, so let's say you don't get any FRET. That says, okay, maybe it's 8 nanometers, maybe it's 10 nanometers, maybe it's 100 nanometers, 1,000 nanometers. You might want to know what that distance is. And it turns out that there are a number of other techniques which you will learn in this course, how you can measure what these so-called bigger distances are. And that is with Fiona, should be Palm or Storm techniques, but that's for later in the semester. Okay. So you can understand how FRET works based on your knowledge that I just gave you. Again, FRET is when you have a donor and you have an acceptor. Let's say this is green and this is red. So what happens is you come in with blue light, it absorbs. Okay, could you do me a favor? Thanks. It absorbs and then ordinarily it emits, right? This is basically a simplified diagram of what we've just shown. However, if there is an acceptor nearby which can take some of this green energy and, you know, steal a little bit of it, then you'll have some energy transfer, and then this dye over here will go up, get excited at the same wavelength that this goes down, goes excited, loses a little bit of energy, and then fluoresces, yet at farther wavelength. And it turns out, so in this case, let's say you have a donor and you're an acceptor nearby. What happens is you go and excite the donor and you get very little of the donor emission, where you get a whole bunch of the acceptor emission. And you can tell the difference because there are different colors. And let's say you have the donor here and you have the acceptor and they're very far apart. So you're getting basically no fret. In which case, you basically get a good amount of green fluorescence. And essentially you get no fluorescence. We'll quantify this a little bit more. So depending on the relative amounts of green versus the red, here if the red is a real lot, you say there's a lot of fret, and here with the little red and lots of green, here there's no fret, and here there's fret. I'm not sure if I said it wrong. Okay? Furthermore, you can look at the lifetime, and this is where the lifetime measurement is incredibly useful. The lifetime of the donor, of just this, what is the lifetime of this going to be? What is the lifetime of this? Here the acceptor is far away. Yeah, whatever the lifetime of the donor is, you know, 3 nanoseconds or something like that. It's essentially unchanged. But here, when it can transfer energy to the acceptor, the lifetime will be much shorter. Why is that? Why is the lifetime much shorter? Yes?
Because maybe because the thermal relaxation under emission goes by quicker, but I'm not sure why.
It's okay. You started it off very well. Okay, let's... can anybody expand on this?
So you're still having to excite the donor first, so you have the photobleaching effect on that, contributing to the lifetime, but then since you're exciting acceptor and having it fluoresce, you also have that lifetime to consider.
Yeah.
Since you have to have both working simultaneously. As soon as green photoplasia, you're not going to get red emission.
I'm not sure what you mean by photobleaching.
Because it's not fluorescing.
Okay, yeah, not fluorescing, although, yeah, generally we don't call that photo bleaching or something, but it's related. Yes?
So, this is what I was thinking, is that during, when it's excited, as an order of absorption, it's on order of temperature.
Right.
Relaxation is on order of
temperature. Yep.
The actual emission, is that on the order of nanoseconds?
Yes.
So just the orders of magnitude is a big thing there. So because when it goes over to the acceptor, it looks like it's exciting again, lines up on femtoseconds, then relaxing on picoseconds, then this is the last step that I'm not quite sure how to complete this. So obviously being such the orders of magnitude being so different, it's going to make it shorter, it's just the last little step.
Yeah, that very good. You're
close. Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead. Yes. Did you?
Yeah, I guess calling this one about 1/k, so you gotta have a larger k.
Ah.
So that's really easy, you know.
K Okay, this is being a little more quantitative. That's right. And here, you have some K radiative rate, which is here. And you also have some K non-radiative rate, right? And the tau initially is 1 over K radiative plus K non-radiative. So that's its lifetime. Now, we have yet another non-radiative mechanism. Because here, it can go down to the ground state, or go down here by passing its energy off to the acceptor. So, K fret. And now so what if this can compete with the radiative rate and the its own non-radiative rate, then this number will be bigger and this number will be smaller. And this is, oh, by the way, so that number will be smaller. And here it is. Here's the normal without the fret, and then with the fret. Yes? Yes. Yes. In fact, it depends on the distance. Radiative or non-radiative, yeah. In general, not, although, you know, if you really want to push it, for example, it can depend on temperature. So you can go colder, and generally K non-radiative gets smaller. Although, you have to remember, this is biological materials that you're looking at. So the range of temperatures that you have access to is pretty small, you know, because you can't freeze the thing, you can't boil the thing, but it can depend on things. Okay? So basically, and if you have here, where it's transferring some energy but not total, it'll be somewhat shorter than this and somewhat longer than this. And it turns out that the distance dependence to this, as I mentioned, it goes as r to the 6. In particular, the energy transfer goes as 1 over 1 plus r over r naught to the 6, where r naught is the distance at which 50% of the energy is transferred. So in this case, r naught, when the r, the distance, is equal to r naught, this is 1, 1 over 1 plus 1 is 1 half. And the curve looks like this. Here's the radius, and here's the energy transfer. And up here, you get that the energy transfer is essentially 1. So what does that mean? What? In terms of the distance between the donor and acceptor? Is it large or small? Small. And over here, is the donor primarily emitting or the acceptor primarily emitting, even though you're exciting the donor? The acceptor. And then here, it's about half. And then here, it's about zero. And at zero, you're going, is the donor acceptor or the acceptor acceptor emitting? Donor. That's right. This corresponds to this, this corresponds to this, and this corresponds to about half. And we'll see next time how to calculate what R0 is. So this is the way energy transfer works. Again, it's an extremely useful technique. And look at this. I'm 3 minutes early.